You've tuned in to Larger Than Life with Pastor Ron Hint of Calvary Chapel, Houston. Here's a preview from Pastor Ron of today's message.
Jesus now is in the temple treasury and he's teaching this. And as he says, I am the light of the world, he's standing right in front of four ginormous candelabras that bear no light, that have been completely extinguished. And he's saying, I am the light. These candelabras, they're out. They gave you brilliance for a time, 7 days to be exact. I'm the light of the world that'll give you light for everyone and throughout eternity.
We can clearly see that when Jesus speaks, he speaks literally. When he said he was the light of the world, he meant it. He even said it while standing next to a giant light so we could understand him better. In today's message, Pastor Ron will challenge you to take a deeper look at Jesus' words. Sometimes if you just skim over or just simply read what is written, you can miss the bigger meaning. Obviously, you want what God wants, and the best way to find that out is to study God's Word. Well, let's join Pastor Ron in the book of John chapter 8 with today's edition of Larger Than Life.
Take out your Bibles, if you would, and turn to the Gospel of John. And we are in chapter 8. We're in the Gospel of John chapter 8. We'll be looking at verses 12 through 20. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you so much that you are the light of the world, that you've come to shine your light upon us in our lost state, in our darkness, in our blindness, to shine upon us truth and eternal life. We're forever thankful for that. And maybe you're here this morning and you don't even know what I'm talking about. Maybe you're not a Christian. You've heard of Christianity and you're not so sure about what it means to be a Christian. Or maybe you've even had some animosity towards Christians. Or maybe you've come here and you need hope. You're in a place of being distraught today or loneliness or hurt or pain. I want you to know Jesus wants to give you comfort. He wants to give healing to that pain because he's the one you've been looking for. He loves you so much. I pray that today you allow the light of his word to shine upon you. He cares for you greatly. And Lord, we're just so thankful that you care about all of us here today. You have a plan and a purpose for us. And you've brought us here again for such a time as this to look at this passage. And so illuminate this truth before us. We pray this in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. So again, the Gospel of John, we've entitled Identity because it's all about seeing the true identity, Jesus high and lifted up. And certainly we see that, as I said, we're going to be looking at verses 12 through 20. But if you just look down in verse 12, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. What an amazing statement. There are all kinds of lights that we deal with every single day. There are flashlights, nightlights, spotlights, floodlights, laser lights, candles, lanterns. On and on and on it goes, right? And they all give out a different amount of light. You know, you might have a little night light and it gives off a little light. You have a flashlight to direct you. You might have a lantern that lights up a larger area. You have a floodlight. And some lights you look into and it can literally blind you and actually do harm to your eyes. But when Jesus talks about, I am the light of the world, I mean, we're talking about mega lumens, right? I mean, we're talking about something in reality that boggles the mind because when Jesus uses this statement, I am, it's a declaration of deity. Again, this is what the book of John is all about, pointing to us the deity of Jesus. When God revealed himself to Moses in the burning bush passage, Moses said, well, who am I going to say is sending me? You know, I'm on a mission from God, but who are you? And he said, you tell them, I am. I am. The Hebrew verb is hayah. It means to be. The Hebrews use the term today, Yashem or Hashem, which means the name. But what God was telling Moses is, you tell the people, I am who I am. I'm God. I'm the great and ever-present one. And so when Jesus in this passage uses that term, he's saying, I'm God. I am the great I am. And by the way, we've made note before that Jesus does so in seven statements. We call them the seven I am statements of Jesus. We saw one already in John chapter 6 and verse 35. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Remember that? Later on, he's going to say, I am the vine. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. Here, he says, I am the light of the world. And that'll be our message this morning, the light of the world, as Jesus is making this great declaration, calling all men out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now, we're going to divide this passage into two main thoughts. And I want you to know we're going to spend a good portion, half of our time, just on verse 12, because there is so much meat here. So let's get into it. First of all, we read, "Then Jesus spoke to them again." Now, the question is, who are the them? Well, it's the crowd of people that had assembled to hear Jesus teach in the temple area. Remember, Jesus came to the temple, and he was there teaching the people. And as he's teaching them, instructing them, we saw this last week, the scribes and the Pharisees threw a woman caught in the very act of adultery into his presence. So, what are you going to do about it, Jesus? And they were taunting him. They cared nothing for the woman. She was simply a tool. In fact, we even said, where's the guy? But Jesus, it says, not once, but twice, stooped down on the ground, began to draw on the ground. And we talked about several thoughts fulfilling scripture. Also, most likely, he was writing down their private sins and making them public, because that's exactly what they did to this woman, caring nothing for her, trying to thrust out something in front of Jesus. And of course, Jesus says, he who is out sin, in other words, who's never had a sinful thought, cast the first stone. And they, beginning at the oldest to the youngest, left. And Jesus says, where are your accusers? She says, none, Lord, neither do I condemn you. Go, you know, sin no more. And she was forgiven. So those people left, and now the crowd is still assembled here. And it's to this group of people still now in the temple area, Jesus makes this statement. It says, I am the light of the world. Now, in order to understand the significance of this statement, we need to remind ourselves of quite a few things. First of which, and foremost, back in chapter 7 and verse 37, we are told that the Feast of Tabernacles had been going on for 7 days, actually, and now it had ended. So we come to the end of chapter 7, and the Feast of Tabernacle ends. Chapter 8, verse 2 says, and the next day. And so the day after the Feast of Tabernacles, Jesus has come into the temple area and he's teaching again. Now, the Feast of Tabernacles was one of what we call three pilgrim feasts. So if you lived within a certain radius of Jerusalem, you were required to come. And as I said, it was a 7-day feast, but it was specifically given so that the children of Israel would celebrate and commemorate the 40-year wanderings in the wilderness, how God provided for them, how God sustained them. And again, Jesus, on the next feast, which is the Feast of Passover, will lay down his life at the cross. So the shadow of the cross is now looming over Jesus. He knows that, so he's using every opportunity now in his teaching to point the people to salvation. That said, we noted that on the last day of the feast, we saw this in chapter 7, and we gave some background. Remember, on the last day of the feast, the high priest would take a golden pitcher, and he would go down to the pool of Siloam, and he would dip the pitcher in the pool of Siloam. Then they would make a long procession throughout the streets of Jerusalem, and they would come to the temple area. And by the way, other priests along with them, the people holding palm branches, and they would sing what's called the ascent songs of the Psalms. And there then the high priest would then pour the water around the altar. And it was symbolic of the fact they were remembering that God had brought water out of the rock. He had provided for them during the wilderness wanderings. And so it was at that moment on the last day of the feast, as that was going on, we saw in John 7, 37, that Jesus said, while that happened, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me, right? Out of his innermost being would flow rivers of living water. And so Jesus used one of those ceremonies to, again, point to his deity. Well, in a similar way, that's exactly what Jesus is doing in this passage. Again, notice Jesus calls himself the light of the world. Well, how's that significant? We'll jump down to verse 20. It says, these words Jesus spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple. Now, this sets the scene for us, and then we begin to understand its pathos. First of all, the temple. This is not Solomon's temple. This is Herod's temple. This is the temple that existed during the time of Christ. Oh, way more elaborate than the temple of Solomon. And so Herod had built this large compound. It took decades to build. And in this compound, you had various courts. Now, you had first, as you entered this perimeter, you entered the court of the Gentiles. And so Gentiles were allowed to actually come into the temple compound. Into the Jewish temple compound. Why? Because God wanted his people to be a light to the Gentiles. They could come there and hear what's going on and hopefully be proselytized, come to the Lord. Then beyond that, there was another perimeter, and this was like a portico. It was soon an open area. It was called the Court of the Women. And it was called that because the women could only go so far. They could go no further except for the next court, which was the court of the priest, to give them a sacrifice if needs be. That said, it wasn't just a court for women. It was a court for women and men. It was just noted that the women couldn't go any further, but men would be there, again, passing through that passage, giving their sacrifices. But it was also a very hustle-bustle place because not only were the people giving their animal sacrifices as worship, it also housed the temple treasury. And so in this court of the women, you have a temple treasury. Again, it's open. It's surrounded by a portico. But in there, on all four walls of the portico, are 13 trumpet-shaped receptacles. As I said, there were 13 of them. They each had a designation. Two were designed for the temple tax. This they would give for the upkeep of the temple. Two were designed actually for women if they needed to purchase pigeons in order to give sacrifice after they had children. One was used as a place to give money for the wood for the altar sacrifices. Another was used for the incense you could give there, and it would provide for the incense that's burning every day in front of the veil to the holiest of holies where the Ark of the Covenant was. Another was used for the upkeep of all of the golden vessels. And then the final six were just used for free will offerings. You just come and give your free will offering to God. It's kind of funny because that's, you know, we make an announcement once a month how we give. And I think, oh, we have money boxes too. So we're kind of connected with that. And so they would just come and they would drop their money in. But it was a very busy place coming into this court of the women and specifically the treasury. People coming and going and giving their free will offerings to the Lord. Now, beyond that, what becomes pertinent to our story is that it also served a significant role during the Feast of Tabernacles. During the Feast of Tabernacles, the priests and the Levites would erect four large candelabras inside this open court in the treasure area. And these large candelabras would have these oil receptacles at the end of them that would, you know, shine as lights. And they would, you know, light them every single evening for all 7 days. The Talmud records for us that each of them was 75 feet high and had a myriad of receptacles for light. In fact, the rabbi said, quote, not a yard in Jerusalem was unlit because of their brilliant illumination. Now, I've been to Israel many times. Let me tell you something. Without electricity, first of all, it's very dark at night. All you have is people using lamps. And you have these large four candelabras shining from the temple top area of Jerusalem. I guarantee you, it would illuminate. It would be a bright light for everyone to see. And that was the purpose. You see, they would light them every single night, these large candelabras. They would sing songs of worship to God. In fact, we're told that some of them would hold lamps or even torches praising God. We're actually told that the Talmud says that two priests would stand at the east gate pointing to the west, and they would recite Ezekiel 8:16. But as for us, O Lord, our eyes are turned towards you. And why did they do this? Again, the purpose of the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Tabernacles was all about commemorating God's guidance and direction and protection during the wilderness wanderings. And how did God guide them? How did God protect them? A cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. It brought them warmth in the desert when it drops low, and it guided and directed them. That's what it was all about. It was also reminiscent of the first temple, which Solomon built, and we're told in 1 Kings chapter 8 that the glory of God shone. And even glory filled the temple so the priests couldn't even continue to minister. And so imagine every night this ceremony took place, lighting these candelabras, this brilliance going on. God's providing for us. God's taking care of us. He's guiding us. So with that in mind, we come to verse 12. Now, again, it's the day after the Feast of Tabernacles, right? Feast of Tabernacles ended in chapter 7, the last day of the feast. That's where they had the ceremony where they poured the water. So the day, the Feast of Tabernacles is over. This is now day 8, you might say. And so Jesus now is in the temple treasury, and he's teaching this. And as he says, I am the light of the world, he's standing right in front of four ginormous candelabras that bear no light, that have been completely extinguished. And he's saying, I am the light. These candelabras, they're out. They gave you brilliance for a time, 7 days to be exact. I'm the light of the world that'll give you light for everyone and throughout eternity. Do you see the commanding force? Jesus would often take things that people saw and experienced and knew, and he says, this only gives light for a while. It illuminated Jerusalem, maybe the surrounding hills. I'm the light of life. And so Jesus is extending this invitation. By the way, notice he says, I'm the light of the world. That's significant. Why? Well, because he's saying it in the temple treasury. Listen, the only people there are Jews. That's it. Gentiles can't go there. But Jesus is reminding them, I didn't come for a select group of people. I came for everyone. That's good news. In John 1:9, Jesus said, I am the true life that gives light to every man. I am so thankful for that. Now again, the Jews were to be the light to the Gentiles. That's prophesied throughout the Old Testament. They knew that. They failed from doing that. And that's why after Jesus rises from the dead, we have the church birthed in Acts chapter 2. And God grafts us, the Gentiles, in by the grace of God. So thankful for that. But Jesus is extending the kingdom to all. And by the way, Jesus has used this invitation many times. He just uses different metaphors, right? This is nothing new. We saw it back in John 6:35. I made mention of it where he says, I am the bread of life, right? He says, I'm the only way, but I'm the bread. And he's using an analogy there, bread. Bread sustains you. You can't live without food. And he says, I'm the bread of life. And if you come to me, you'll never hunger. I'll satisfy you spiritually and eternally. He used it back in John chapter 7 where he says, I'm the living water. He who comes to me will never thirst. He used it back in John chapter 4 when he talked about the woman in the well. You drink this water, you thirst again, but I'm the water of life, and out of you would come fountains of living water. And here, of course, he says, I am the light of the world. Now, again, these candelabras, of course, were symbolic. Everybody knew that. They were just symbols. They were to remind them. Remember, God provided for us. God took care of us. We remember God's Shekinah glory, you know. Well, Jesus is saying, you don't need symbols anymore. I'm here. I'm here in your midst. I want a relationship with you. You can have a relationship with me. I want to give you life, and we can fellowship together. Wow, that's powerful. So make no mistake about it. Here, Jesus is making a declaration, as I said when we began, of his deity, the fact that he is God. In fact, we read in the scriptures over and over again, God is light. God is light. And then David said in Psalm 27 and verse 1, the Lord is my light. If God is light, then he's my light. I can't live without him. And then you come to the last book in the Old Testament, the book of Malachi, one of the last prophecies given concerning Jesus, concerning the coming Messiah. Malachi 4:2, and it says, the Son, capital S, U-N, the Son of righteousness. Speaking of the brilliance of the coming Messiah, he will come with healing in his wings. And the prophets knew that. And the rabbis knew that when the Messiah comes, he'll be the light of God. And Jesus said, I'm the light of God. I'm the light of the world. If you come to me, you no longer have to live in darkness. You can have forgiveness of sins. You don't have to offer up repeatedly sacrifice after sacrifice. I'll be your sacrifice. I'll be your savior. You can have life. Now, when he talks about light, and I want to come back to this thought again. Certainly, light does a bunch of things. Light dispels darkness, right? It dispels darkness. If you're trying to get somewhere and you use a flashlight, it lets you see, you know, problems in the way so that you can clear it out. That's good. It clears obstacles. Light also allows you to see if there are problems there. I think of God's light. His word always shines in our hearts, right? And we say, ooh, I need to change something here, you know. Kind of like going into one of your children's room if you have young kids, you know. From the outside, it might look fine. Then you turn on the light switch and you go, a hurricane went through here, right? So light is good for that respect. But another thing about light that maybe you've never thought about before, and that is the fact that light bears witness of itself. Light testifies of itself. What I mean by that is this. When we go into a room and we turn on a light switch, we don't go, hep, there's the light. You don't have to say it. It bears witness of itself. I mean, it testifies of itself. Light is self-evident. And I say that because there's something interesting that we read in the scriptures. First of all, in John chapter 1 and verse 7, we read that John the Baptist came bearing witness of the light. So John the Baptist came saying, Jesus is the light. And then here we have Jesus pointing to himself, I am the light. Now that's interesting. If light bears witness of itself, why does John and why does Jesus have to say, I am the light? Why? Because what kind of people don't see light? Blind people. Blind people. And see, here's the problem. The Bible says the God of this age has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. And here's the thing. We're blind. Before we come to Christ, we're blind. We're not only in darkness, we're blind in our darkness. And we need direction to say, he's the light. And if you go to him, you'll be able to see. You'll be able to see the truth, and that truth will set you free. Oh, how I love that. So Jesus says, I am the light. And he, let's move on. He says, and he who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of light. Now, Jesus says, he who follows me. So if I want that light in my life, I want to change, then I need to follow him. But I have to ask myself, what does it mean to follow Jesus? Because I know a lot of people that say they follow Jesus, and before I was even saved, I wasn't walking with Jesus, but I knew they weren't walking with Jesus. And now that I'm a Christian, I have somewhat of an idea what it means to follow Jesus, and people say they follow Jesus, they're not really following Jesus. So what does it mean to follow Jesus? Well, listen, in John chapter 6, you remember, after Jesus fed the 5,000, Jesus said to the people, you're following me only because I filled your stomachs and you saw the miracles. And he began to explain to them what it really meant to follow him. And it tells us in John 6 and verse 66, from that time, many of his disciples followed him no more. That means you can even call yourself a disciple and not really be following Jesus. So I want to know what it means to follow Jesus. So the word that is used here in the Greek language, akouleuthein, it has five meanings. I think that'll help us understand what it means to really follow Jesus. First of all, this word that's translated here, follows, was used to describe a soldier who followed his captain. Listen, a true soldier follows his commanding officer to the T. If he doesn't or she doesn't, they're in big trouble, right? Those of you in the military say, oh yeah, that's right. So the same is true of a person who really follows Jesus. Listen, Jesus is mine. He's yours. He's our commander in chief. And thus, I'm going to follow him. I'm going to obey his commands. 2 Timothy 2, 3 and 4 puts it this way. Endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in this endeavor entangles himself with the affairs of this life. I'm not living in the world, but rather I seek to please him who enlisted me as a soldier. Secondly, this word was used to describe a servant who was at the beckoned call of his master. Listen, a person who follows Jesus is a servant, and a servant who joyfully serves his Lord. So Jesus, you know, even gave us the example. I came not to be served, but to serve. He even gave us an example to follow. So I need to serve as Jesus served. So it means I'm serving Jesus, and guess what? When I serve Jesus, the flip side of that is, I'll serve others. How about that? That goes hand in hand. 1 Thessalonians 1:9 says that we move from living our life of all the idols and everything to serve the true and living God. And Galatians 5:13, by love, we serve one another. So to follow here, using this very word here, speaks of a soldier obeying his commanding officer and a servant obeying his master. Oh, but wait, there's more. Thirdly, it was used to describe a person who was in need of counsel, and having received wise counsel, accepted it and followed it. Listen, a person who follows Jesus Christ is, first of all, counseled by Christ. They're saying, I want your counsel. What do you have to say, Jesus? And by the way, all of his counsel that comes from his word is perfect. Isaiah 9:6 says he's a wonderful counselor. And if I'm going to follow his counsel, what am I following? I'm following his word, what you have right in front of you in your lap. Listen, Psalm 119, 105 says, God's word is a lamp. It's a light to our feet, right? A lamp to our feet, a light to our path. So a true believer who follows Jesus is seeing him as a wise counselor and following his word.
Thanks for joining us here today on Larger Than Life as we go through the Gospel of John. Gospel means good news, and the good news that John shares is summed up in the most well-known verse in the Bible, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. That's good news indeed. Today's teaching from Pastor Ron Hint and others like it can be found on our mobile app, so go to ltlradio.org to find the link. Larger Than Life is also available in podcast format, so please subscribe if you want to stay connected and immersed in our teachings. In case you've forgotten, that website again is ltlradio.org. Larger Than Life is a ministry of Calvary Houston and Pastor Ron Hint in Friendswood, Texas. If you're in the Friendswood area, we'd love to meet you. We have Sunday morning services at 9 and 11 a.m. and every Wednesday at 7 p.m. If you have questions about what you heard today, we'd love to hear from you. Feel free to call us at 281-648-5800. Again, that number is 281-648-5800. Thanks so much for listening. We're so happy that you spent time with us today. Join us again next time as Pastor Ron has more to teach from the Gospel of John right here on Larger Than Life.